display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. How great thou art.
It's an honor and a blessing to stand before you this afternoon and share just a few words and thoughts. And I want to thank this family for allowing me to do so. I also want to thank you for your faithfulness in caring for Claude and for the ones in this family who've come today to say that they care. In probably one of the best known and best, if I can say it that way, passages of Scripture, David says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff. They comfort me. You prepare the table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." One other verse that I want to share is, and this is to me is just a special verse, and it simply says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." I often use a New American Standard Bible, which I believe is a good translation. We always call it in our church the Toccoa Falls translation, because that's what their students and folks that have served in our church have always used, the professors. And it says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his godly ones." And you know, a lot of people will tell you, they'll say, "Well, I ain't no saint." And then they'll turn right around and say they're a Christian. Well, they're arguing with themselves and don't have sense enough to know it. So a saint is simply a person who's been born again. And by all the testimony that y'all have given and of what Claude gave himself, he had been saved. So when we think of this verse, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. I remember something I read a long time ago that said that when a Christian dies, the Lord never sees someone leaving. He just sees a child coming home. And that's why it's precious. You know, you hurt, and you've been through this kind of time before, and it hurts to lose someone we love. But if you turn it around and try to look at it through God's eyes, they've been welcomed home. And that's what we need to try to remember and focus on. Heavenly Father, we're thankful to be in your house. We're thankful to be in a place that's designated as your house for this time of worship and remembering and just giving thanks to you. I pray that you would bless this family and help them. We know that, Lord, there is always a pain and a hurt when someone we love dies and leaves this world. But we thank you and we rejoice in having the knowledge and the peace that Claude is with you. And I pray that you would comfort our hearts with that assurance. Bless all these that have helped this family. Bless Brian and all the ones here at Sandifer's. And we just ask you that this would be a time today where truly our hearts could rejoice because of the homegoing of this one we love, but also just because of who you are and that you make it all possible. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Don't you love that time when you're in the garden or just in the yard or in the house by yourself, driving down the road, and you're either reading the word or praying, and the Lord just assures you that you're His. And I love that old song, and it's something that we miss out a lot on because we don't take the time to do those kind of things. And every one of us, no matter how much time we take, ought to take more. And if we aren't taking any, then we ought to be ashamed if we're professing Christians that we don't take the time to love the Lord and let Him love us in that way. There is a time for everything, a time for every activity under heaven, wrote Solomon, a time to be born and a time to die. And we're all here today because of the truth of that verse in Ecclesiastes chapter 3. As a part of his life here on earth, time came for Claude Pelfrey to be born, and after 76 years of life, his time came to die. And if the Lord Jesus continues to tarry and delay his return for his church, every one of us in this room will one day be in this place. There may not be a flag over our casket. There wouldn't be over mine. But I appreciate that Claude served in our country. And from what I've heard, been told, he loved it and enjoyed it, and it meant a lot to him. It ought to mean a lot to all of us. But we're all, unless Jesus comes back to get us, we're all going to face death. Not, it could be for others that we love, but we're going to face it personally in a way that none of us obviously have ever experienced. So there's a need to know that we'll leave this world one day. And it's because of your relationship with Claude that you, who are family and friends, are here today. If you did not know him, never heard of him, you wouldn't be sitting where you're sitting. So that, you know, that means something. And we ought to build on those relationships and remember that verse, there is a time to be born and a time to die. And because of the fact that there's a time to die, you know, the death of someone we love is normally seen as bad news. Bad news. Some people, unfortunately, will always say, well, they're in a better place. And that always gets my attention because I think we'd all have to admit we've been to places like this where we are today, and there'd been never any evidence that the person was ready to meet Jesus. Listen, if we leave this world and we're not ready to meet him, we're not going to a better place. So we need to be careful about saying that, and we need to be even more careful that we're ready to go. Because I was in here in this same place Tuesday afternoon, and you don't know. We just don't know. We could be back here Saturday, Sunday afternoon, next week. We need to be ready. In 1 Corinthians, you know, when we think about the why there's death, I remember when I was probably a teenager, I remember reading, I had been saved, but it was not long after that, and I remember reading, you remember those little columns that Billy Graham used to have in the paper, My Answer? How many of you remember those? They may still publish them. I don't ever see a newspaper anymore. But there was a woman wrote him a question and says, why do we even have death? Which, you know, may sound to some of us like a foolish question, but there's a lot of people wonder that. And the simple answer is sin. Sin is the reason we have death. Had there never been any sin, there wouldn't be any death. But sin, through the first Adam, brought death into this world. And in 1 Corinthians 15, we read, "So also it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living person. The last Adam was a life-giving spirit. However, the spiritual isn't first, but the natural, then the spiritual. The first man is from the earth. The second man is from heaven." And Jesus is that second man. He came. He's the second Adam. And he's the one who can undo, if I can say it that way, what Adam ushered in. So it's because of the Lord Jesus that we have the hope of eternal life. And it's because of the Lord Jesus that we have, if we know him, if we've been born again, the promise of eternal life. For just a minute or two, I want to share with you three verses in John chapter 3. You've heard these, I'm sure. If you've gone to church and listened, you've heard these three verses in John 3. "Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, 'Rabbi, we know that you have come from God as a teacher, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him.' Jesus replied and said to him, 'Truly, truly, or verily, verily, or most assuredly, I say to you, unless someone is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God.'" Now, you know, there's some things that even people who would consider themselves Bible scholars would look at in God's Word and say, well, that could mean this, it could mean that, and there's not but one thing this can mean. That there's no way to misunderstand what Jesus said to Nicodemus. He said, unless you're born again, you're not going to heaven. You're not going to see the kingdom of God. You're not going to experience that here, and you sure won't spend eternity with him. That's pretty matter of fact. I mean, there's not room for a loophole there. There's no way to wiggle out of it. It's just cut and dry. Now, Nicodemus was sort of in a predicament once Jesus said this to him, because if we read these verses clearly, he was a man of the Pharisees. He was a ruler of the Jews, very religious, had a lot of authority, educated, a lot of things in his favor. But he still had this, and I don't know if curiosity is the right word, but it's the only word I can come up with right now. He had this curiosity. He was drawn to Jesus because some of the things that Jesus had done. So even though he was a Pharisee and a member of the Sanhedrin, ruler of the Jews, he went to Jesus at night, and he's talking to him. And Jesus said something to him that we all need to be certain of. And I'm saying this from my heart. I don't know some of you even by name. I sure don't know any of our hearts except for mine. If you want to see Jesus, if you want to go to where Claude Pelfrey has gone this past Saturday, you better make sure you've been born again. There's no other way. There's no other way to get there. You won't get it just by going to church. There's not anybody on the planet that believes people who are saved ought to go to church more than me, but that's not what saves you. You don't get it by putting a lot of money in the offering plate. I'm not trying to discourage you from doing that, but that's not what saves you. We go to heaven. We see the kingdom of God when we're born again. And Jesus said very plainly, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. For just a minute, think about what that meant to Nicodemus. Now, he's a Jewish man. he had been taught all of his life that he would go to heaven. He was a very knowledgeable and well-educated man. He had been taught all of his life that because he was Jewish and because of his position, that would be what took him to heaven. Jesus says, uh-uh, not what it is. You and I, if we're saved, aren't saved because mom and daddy was saved. We're not saved because grandparents were saved. We're not saved because so-and-so was our pastor or whatever. We're saved because at some point in our lives, for me it was when I was 16, we realized we were lost. You can't get saved till you realize you're lost. Never happened. And then the Holy Spirit speaks to us and literally draws us to the Lord, to the truth of God's word, and we ask Jesus to come into our hearts, to our lives, and we're born the second time. We're born again. If you've been saved, it always troubles me when you ask somebody, are you a Christian? Have you ever been saved? And they say, well, I hope so, or I think so. And you know, it, without trying to be funny about it, because it's not a funny thing to talk about, it would be like walking to Virginia and saying, Virginia, when you were, how did you get here? Were you born or something? I mean, how else would she get here? Sarah gave birth to her. How many years ago? You don't need to answer that. But that's how we get here. And we're born again when we receive Jesus. If we've never given our life to him, we're lost. We're absolutely lost, and we'll never see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus was a good man. Not any doubt about that. But goodness doesn't get us to heaven. Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. I remember when I was lost. I remember the night I was saved. If you've been born again, you'll remember it. You will know about it, and you're not going to forget it. It's the most important decision you'll ever make. The night I was saved in June the 19th of 1973, I never forget, after Preacher John led me to the Lord, his daddy was there that night. And Preacher Carly McKnight came up to me, and I did not know him at that time. And he put his arm around my shoulder. Never forget what he said. He said, son, that's what he called me, son, it's the most important decision you will ever make. I was 16. I'd never made a lot of important decisions. And that didn't register with a 16-year-old the way it does now at 65. It doesn't register, you know, with an 18-year-old or a 20-year-old. But I promise you, if you were saved at age 6, it's still the most important decision you'll ever make. And if you've never made it, you're being foolish. You're acting. You know what a fool is the one who says there is no God. And to not receive Jesus as your personal Savior, to reject the Word of God, is a foolish, foolish thing to do. Jesus gives us new life. And that life which comes when we're saved, when we're born again, is possible only through him. That is the only reason that we have hope and the promise to see our loved ones again, like Claude Pelfrey. No greater, as Preacher Carly McKnight told me, no greater decision than to receive Jesus as your Savior. I would just like to close and ask you this. Have you ever made that decision? Have you made the most important decision in life? Do you know the Lord? Does he know you? Do you belong to Jesus? And can you say from your heart, Jesus is mine, and know that it's the truth? If not, I urge you to make that choice today. I also urge you to allow the Lord to be the comforter of your hearts, the strength in the steps you take, and the one who will keep you and sustain you, help you to grow closer to the Lord during this time of loss. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're so very thankful that you loved us so much that you sent Jesus to die for our sins. And Lord, we're thankful that you give us reason to live. You give us a purpose in living. Lord, you're our help when we need help. You're our strength when we're weak. You're the comforter through the Holy Spirit when we need comfort. Lord, you are our everything, and we worship you and praise you. And I ask you to comfort this family, especially these sisters and the ones that have come today in this family. Just help them to be aware of your presence and to be submissive completely to your will and to the leadership of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, help us all, the ones of us who know you, help us to choose correctly each day to follow you. And Lord, if there's even one that's here that's never been saved, never been born again, or isn't sure of it, may this be the day when they make that choice. Bless during the remainder of our service and our trip to the cemetery. Give us safety and just have your way in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If I surveyed all the good things that come to me from above, if I count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of him beyond mortal king, and I'm sure that he'd grant it again. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. Places of beauty we long to see here below, but time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of the rapture, together we'll stand anew while I stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty to stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you. If I surveyed all the good things that come to me from above, if I count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of Him beyond mortal ken, and I'm sure that He'd grant. I want to stroll.